our starting point is that change is inevitable and we are passing through the change, and then we are looking into that change and trying to drive that change. From that perspective, we are trying to envisage what would be, what shall be an information society, maybe. Because in the last session, when we talk about the disadvantage group, when we talk about the disadvantage in an information society, will be entirely different condition. It may be a new techno-social condition. Then from that point, we are starting. Our team mainly focused on media and culture, and in special condition, we also look into global common knowledge commons. Then our team was, these are our team members. Then Vinesh will take.
I'll start with the preamble. Be a unique platform for reflection of all socio-cultural diversities in the creation and reproduction. Just a second.
So from 164, you can reduce the
font. Yeah.
Just move that slightly.
Bottom.
Move the bottom. Move that bottom. Yes.
One more.
Yeah, that's better. Yeah. So be a unique platform for reflection of all socio-cultural diversities in the creation and reproduction of knowledge and content by providing opportunities of participation, membership, and engagement to all. Yeah, next I'll come to principles. The first one is internet as social media be understood as a space which is plural, diverse, democratic, open, accessible with low entry barriers and adaptable to different forms of articulation. The second is have measures in place to prevent the internet from becoming an ordinary economic commodity and instead espouse norms and values that further social entrepreneurship and creative exchange. Have scope to address the issues of representation and recognition of diverse cultures and redistribution of knowledge or information irrespective of existing inequalities in society. Be a platform to make public policy making process more participatory, creative, and inclusive. Politics of the architecture of the internet be such that it lend itself to democratic practices of cultural expression, creation, and reproduction. Be a platform to make public policy making process more, yeah, I've done that, sorry. Politics of the architecture, yeah, that is also done, sorry. Be guided by self-regulation that guards against consolidation or concentration of ownership. Facilitate global knowledge sharing and enhance creative exchange of cultural processes and productions. The action points are adopt an ethical framework that evolves with the techno-social scenarios of dynamic information society. Promote collaborative effort in order to form supportive architecture, that is both hardware and software, and intermediaries who facilitate the use of internet, the last mile connectivity we are talking of. Provide opportunities to build multiplicity in the skills, capacities for practices in network society. Enhance, expand techno structure in order to include diverse users by recognizing the distinctiveness of existing skill sets. The disenfranchised and differently abled. Reform legal framework and root it in the local geographies to support free, open, collaborative and creative efforts. Recognize and retain best practices while being self-reflexive and open to alternatives. provide environment that promotes trust, confidence, transparency and dissent. Equitable sharing of information including codes, architecture and points of origin by doing away with obsolescence based technology free from corporate grips. Yeah, some points where we were pondering over was language not to be prescriptive but you know rather enabling and lends itself to the culture of participation. Yeah, so this is basically the
Good morning all. Our team, which comprises of Makran, Malti, Sujan, and myself, Pratima, we have worked on the theme, Internet as an open and competitive marketplace and consumer rights. As there has been a saying, with ICT, geography is now history. So, keeping this in mind, we have framed some of the public policy principles. The preamble, we look at it as Internet to provide as a tool with screens and passwords that is free, fair, democratic, just, and equitable market platform. As well as some of the public policies, policy principles we have identified being one, maintain a free and open architecture to facilitate national and global marketplace. Two, open doors to facilitate more forms of economy such as peer-to-peer networks. Encourage healthy competition and reduce unfair trade practices. A comprehensive policy to encompass both offline and online transactions, thereby ensuring technology neutrality. And ensure secure online environment. These are the five principles we have identified, and some of the action plans pertaining to the principles being one, free and open market means minimum government intervention and low entry barriers, provide a level playing field for big and small players both, provide a regulatory framework for securing payment options, framework for data privacy, and also provide for, which is very important at this point in time, to provide a quick and cheap way of dispute resolution for online transactions, and also form a common Indian language platform which enables e-commerce websites to use Indian languages and take it to a larger platform. So these are some of the action plans we have. Why? Mm-hmm. Your point number four includes both offline and online transaction using technology neutrality. Maybe you can elaborate.
Right. While we frame regulations, there's one thing, Information Technology Act also for that matter, whenever we frame policies and regulations at the government levels or at the state levels, we need to ensure that it's online and offline transactions. Tomorrow there may be something else which is called technology or something else. So to bring in that kind of a technology neutrality where all these players can have an equal level playing field is what we are looking at in terms of technology neutrality. So whenever we are trying to implement certain policies, we need to try and identify that there is enough technology neutrality and there is no repetition of laws. You cannot have a consumer law for offline contracts, a consumer law for online contracts. Have a technology neutral form of a regulation which has both players here. Be it physical form or be it a virtual form, have the same set of regulations. Don't multiply regulations unnecessarily and make it more complicated. Whereas it is living in a very complicated legal structure. So let's not worsen the situation. So that's what we are looking at. Thanks.
What you are actually saying is bring the legal framework, make it recognize the reality of online e-commerce or whatever, and bring the legal framework up to date.
Exactly.
Existing
up to date and maybe even going further. We never saw, we saw only industrial revolution. We did not see information revolution.
In the law.
Maybe in the times to come, we may see some other revolution happening. So we were trying to keep it as, like, for example, I'll just give you an example from my perception. Contract law. So something which is very technology neutral. Of course, we cannot be as technology neutral as it is. Given any form of transaction, these are the basic features we have. And these are how you overcome hurdles when it comes to these contractual terms. So that's where I'm looking at. Yeah, to an extent, to a large extent, keep it up to date. Yes.
My concern is about facilitate national and global marketplace and other form a common Indian language platform. Where we can locate a regional marketplace. Regionality is different. When national is not the regional thing. Other common language of Indian language. What's a common language system of Indian languages? When we are talking about the diversity of the culture and social conditions, we are responsible to talk about in this kind of diversity of language systems. And then, otherwise, when we are talking about a democratic market, at the same time, we are excluding some kinds of languages when we are doing a common language system. Then, how can we include these two things?
Okay, will you take this question? Yeah.
That's a good point. Actually, we are thinking that in order to have national reach in our country, it has to be the e-commerce websites have to be in local language. So if I'm in a remote village somewhere trying to buy something, and if the website does courier or send those things to that place, then I should be able to read in my language. Now, what happens sometimes is you can read fonts of your language on some website, but you can't read them on some other website. You need to download other fonts or something like that. So what we're saying is that there should be a common platform, Unicode or whatever, that websites, if they want to have multilingual websites or versions of their websites, then they should have this common platform so that it is usable across platforms. So suppose if I can read Kannada website of Flipkart, and I should be able to read it off say Amazon.in also. I did not download another font. So that's what we meant by having a common Indian language platform so as to enable more reach to the e-commerce.
You can stroke regional languages.
You have to say a multilingual framework or supporting common Indian languages.
Yeah. Right.
Plural, yeah.
Okay.
Just the plural.
And also, I think what they're saying is free and open, national, global, maybe local, regional, national, global marketplaces, not only national and global.
No, the marketplace is not regional. The marketplace is national. The users are regional and the language is theirs to facilitate a national market. It's not a regional market.
So that depends whether the main legal framework of the market is national. I mean, most of the legal frameworks are mostly national, though there are state-level legal aspects also, but they're generally weaker than the national aspects, and you're calling it a national framework, therefore. See, my question was about point one, which says minimum government intervention, and all the points, subsequent points, to me looks like government interventions. So I would need to, I'd like to understand what do you mean by government intervention in the first point, because second, third, fourth, fifth are regulatory points, and sixth is possibly a point where governmental positive intervention may be needed in supporting, putting in money, etc., for common language-based work, which normally hasn't happened by the market forces, more than perhaps in 2-3 centers, not in 28 Indian states. So almost all of them involves, to me, a governmental angle. So what is the minimum government intervention? What's the meaning of that in first, therefore?
Just a second.
Yes.
I think this is a very important point for all the groups, and I have actually put it down earlier. I would like you to respond, but I want it to be taken up in the next session in more elaboration across groups, which is level playing field versus intervention.
Because it's tied to regulation.
Yeah, which is tied to this, and then we can stack up all these sets of themes together and discuss them.
Discuss together.
Please do.
I'll just answer in one line. What we're saying is minimum, not no. And by minimum, we see it absolutely necessary for government to intervene and not create any artificial entry barriers.
Could you give an example of that?
As you said, no private player is taking up a common multilingual platform creation. Maybe government can do that. But creating artificial barrier, like saying small players are not accountable, so any person who wants to sell on the internet should have and share capital of at least 50 lakhs. That's, in our opinion, an artificially created entry barrier. Or should have a license, like we have license Raj. Or even like a rickshaw puller needs a license, right? So not a artificial created, absolutely necessary. So we are saying it's no government intervention, and as you rightly said, all of them require government intervention. But to have the pathos that it should be minimum and not try to maximize intervention. Let 1,000 flowers bloom in a sense. Let people take initiative and let it happen as much as possible. And that's what we mean by the second point, open doors to facilitate newer forms of economy such as peer-to-peer networks. Now, the example of this is, we discussed it of libraries where you say deposit 5 books and you can borrow 5 books, but you can borrow only when you deposit your own books. So there is no commercial transaction, but it's a peer-to-peer network where you contribute in kind and you benefit in kind. Similarly, there are now peer-to-peer journals licensed under Creative Commons, right? So earlier when you published, you went to JSTOR or something like that, and it created huge barrier for people who couldn't afford that access. But this is again a kind of peer-to-peer interaction which is possible over the internet, and it is out of the market logic, to use the expression used given in our, so something like that. So let it evolve. We don't know where it will go, but let's not strangulate it by having government regulation for ostensibly public purposes. That's what we are trying to get at. You'd like to add something?
Can I add something?
Yeah, sure.
I would agree. Sorry, what happened? Hello? Okay. I would add to what Makram has said. Yes, there is a requirement. What we meant was, even you can say I had a dilemma about it. We were talking, we were discussing about putting up it as it is, or we should just go away with this. What he is trying to say is, government intervention is, yes, minimum government intervention for entering into the open marketplace. But government intervention is required to make the online environment more secure and to create more trust and confidence for the consumer to enter into the online environment. Because until unless there is some regulation, something, some trust is there, and a consumer, it will be more convenient for the consumer or business to enter into the environment if he feels okay, so there is some kind of secure environment which I see so that I can enter the online environment. That's it.
One more point. Talking about these quick and cheap ways of dispute resolutions, of course there have been very many new ways of alternative disputes which have come in, and the more recent ones being the online dispute resolutions, which one of our team members is doing her doctoral research on. So these online dispute resolutions should be encouraged to a larger extent, where there is the least state and government or judiciary intervention, and the parties are able to go in for a quick and faster a cheaper mode of redressing their disputes. So if this can also be encouraged through these policies, I think we can go a long way through e-commerce portals. Yeah.
I also had a question which we may want to defer to the next set of discussions. Is there any residual kind of regulatory arena that might not be encompassed by just an updation of current law in different domains of commerce, which require particularly the internet to be governed? Let us say, for instance, in an export-import regime. So in which case, you're not only talking about contract law as an Indian contract law, you might even think about the internet as a domain for lawmaking, which pertains to particularly, particular issues not encompassed by current legislation. Although the point about updation is very well taken.
I think one area is data privacy, which was not so acute in brick and mortar companies, but for internet, we need some new guidelines.
And I think there's a huge good service dichotomy in digital products. That is something we'll really have to focus on, perhaps, given this e-commerce. I mean, I really don't understand some of the ways in which products are traded today. What do you call them? License, sale? What is it that we are calling them? So, to try and fit them either as goods or services and even fix taxes on them has been a very difficult task for the governments. A new kind of an intervention which needs a whole lot of study, a different thinking completely. Otherwise, we can just try and fit them into one of the laws.
Using the internet for internet dispute resolution, we really need to understand what we mean by that and unpack it a little more. Okay. As it is, even now, access to criminal justice, just plain justice, is heavily mediated by your social location, and things never come for legal redress because people give up by not filing complaints. Correct. So there is a huge lack of access to legal rights. In such a context, providing this option can actually militate against people's legal rights in a real sense. And I also want to say that often people compromise more readily, the powerless compromise more readily than the ones who are powerful. So often this quick and cheap can mean that you lose the battle quickly.
No, I think there is also confusion here maybe, and I would like you to clarify. I don't know whether this is meant to refer to dispute resolution on the internet. I think they're talking about dispute resolution with regard to e-commerce. That is
absolutely but whereas all levels of people enter into e-commerce, then the consumer, as it is, has not had adequate rights addressed, and inequalities can only grow rather than go down. So in that context, also it is applicable. That's the point.
Yeah, I would like to also, when it comes to business,
apart from the online dispute resolutions as such, social justice is also playing different games like blogs, consumer blogs, where they are trying to put up a lot of these issues. Credit rating of these merchants is happening big time on the internet. So that is also some good way of social justice that we can take in this internet mediated world, where the merchant is actually offensive about the credit rating he has. So that is also another way, a good way of going about with social justice, where government is least intervening on all of these. Go ahead, make your credit ratings, do whatever you want. But there also, the consumer is benefited. But with online dispute resolutions, yes, sometimes there is always a possibility, that the consumer, because there was one instance of one of my students who had purchased, just one quick minute, one of my students who had purchased something from one of the online portals, and he was not happy with the product and he wanted to return the product and whatsoever, he complains, he goes back to the portal where he purchased the product, and despite repeated complaints, he has not got anything, so he just posted something on Mouthshut. Of course, Mouthshut did enable the two parties to come together and come to some kind of a compromise where he was happy with the compromise. Not happy in the negative sense that he had to take what was given, but it was a good redressal that they gave him. So maybe if there are instances like these where it can happen with the online platforms, that can also take us a long way. Yeah, I look at it more positively.
Thanks.
I just want to add this minimum word I wanted to discuss.